So I'd like to talk about what happens when you wire up resistors in series or in parallel. Let's take a look at a specific example. Right now we're looking at a case where we have two 12 ohm resistors wired in series. We're going to replace these two resistors with one equivalent resistor. And I want to be very clear when I say equivalent. What does this mean? Well, if I want to replace two circuit elements with a single equivalent circuit element, what I'm really saying is that I want the voltages and currents everywhere else in the circuit to remain the same after the replacement. In this particular example, the equivalent resistance is 24 ohms. I've just added the two 12 ohm resistors together. It might seem obvious that one needs to do this, but let me give two different arguments why resistors in series add. I want to start off with a geometrical argument. Let's imagine that each of these two resistors have the same resistivity and the same cross-sectional area. Let's call that cross-sectional area A. Let's call the resistivity rho. Let's assume that resistor R1 has length L sub 1 and resistor R2 has length L sub 2. The formula for resistance is rho L over A. Let's now think about the geometry of the equivalent resistor. If we look at these two resistors, R1 and R2, and we smoosh them together into a single resistor, what would the length be of that resistor? Well, it would just be L1 plus L2. The formula for the equivalent resistor is rho times the total length divided by the cross-sectional area. After I distribute the rho across the L1 and L2, I wind up with just R1 and R2. This provides an intuitive geometrical argument why the equivalent resistor should be the sum of the two resistors in series. Let me give another argument, though, based on voltages and currents. As I mentioned a moment ago, the whole idea behind replacing a set of circuit components with a single equivalent circuit element is that we want the voltages and the currents everywhere else in the circuit to remain the same. So let's go ahead and force them to be the same and see what happens. Let's call the voltage across both of these resistors to be the voltage V. The same voltage has to show up across the equivalent resistance. Let's call the voltages across resistors R1 and R2, V1 and V2. Because voltages add, we know that V equals V1 plus V2. Let's call the current through these two resistors I. The same current would then need to flow through our equivalent resistor. Using Ohm's law through the equivalent resistor, we know that V equals I times R equivalent. Applying Ohm's law to voltage V1, we have IR1, and applying it to the second resistor, we have IR2. We're immediately left with the same equation. Of course, to reach that conclusion, you'll have to believe that voltages in series also add. That falls from properties related to the Coulomb force. Let's go ahead and move on to resistors in parallel, and I'll have more to say about voltages in series in a future video. Again, I would like to make two different arguments to show how resistors in parallel can be combined. First, let's look at a geometrical argument. Furthermore, let's assume that resistors R1, R2, and R3 have cross-sectional areas A1, A2, and A3 respectively. Our goal here is to replace these three resistors in parallel with an equivalent resistor that maintains the same currents and voltages elsewhere in the circuit. What would this equivalent resistor look like? By observing my drawing, it looks like the cross-sectional area of our equivalent resistor would be A1 plus A2 plus A3. The length and resistivity would be the same as that in the other drawing. Resistance is rho L divided by the cross-sectional area. The same formula holds for each of the three individual resistors too, but the cross-sectional area is different in each case. Continuing from here, let's take the reciprocal of each side of this equation. If we look at this first term, we see that it's just the reciprocal of resistance R1. The second term is the reciprocal of resistance R2, and the same thing for resistor R3. What we can conclude from this is that in order to combine resistors in parallel, one needs to first take the reciprocal of each individual resistor, add them together, and then take the reciprocal of the result. That's the geometric argument. Now let's take a look at an argument related to currents and voltages in the circuit. Let's say that we have current I flowing into this set of resistors. Because our goal is to find an equivalent resistor, we know that the same current I will have to flow through it as well. Let's say that in our original circuit fragment, we have voltage V across each of these resistors. Since we're finding an equivalent resistance, we know that the same voltage V should show up across that as well. When the current enters this circuit, it will divide. Some of the current, let's call it I1, will flow through resistor R1. Some of the current, let's call it I2, will flow through resistor R2. And finally, some of the current, let's call it I3, will flow through the third resistor. The currents flowing through each resistor have to add up to the total current flowing. If we now look at our equivalent circuit, we can say that V equals I times R equivalent. Therefore, for I, we know that it's V divided by R equivalent. If we look at our original circuit, we know also that V equals I1 R1, and a similar equation holds for the other resistors. From each of these three equations, we can substitute for I1, I2, and I3. Of course, we ended up with the same formula. In the next video, we'll apply what we've learned and look at a few examples where we have resistors in series and in parallel to combine. If you enjoyed watching this video, then you might be interested in following our playlist and learning more about the fundamentals of electrical circuits.